Prima Media in Johannesburg, I'm Sane Dlamini, Dr. Hloni Bookholane is in conversation with Polity about his book titled Becoming a Doctor. So Dr. Bookholane, give us some background into your life growing up and talk to us about when you realized you wanted to become a doctor.
So I grew up in Mthatha, which is, you know, the bustling metropolis in the Eastern Cape, before I moved to East London. And yeah, while I was at boarding school, that's when, I think in grade 11, when I decided I wanted to go into medicine after my ideas of becoming a professional sports player ended. I decided to apply for medicine. So I didn't get into medicine straight out of high school. I did physiotherapy before that, and then I reapplied to get into medicine.
Did you write this book as a guide for future medical students?
Initially, the idea was that for it to be something that, you know, someone who's going through the process can look at and read and see that, you know, whatever struggles they might be having, someone else has gone through them, or the beautiful things, you know, this is what this is all about. But then when I started writing, it became much more of me reflecting about my own experiences throughout medical school and starting to work, which ultimately were very relatable experiences.
As a doctor, you've had to adjust to life under the COVID-19. How has the pandemic affected you professionally and personally? The one must have bled into the other during the pandemic.
So I moved back from the United States in July last year, and then back to Cape Town by August. So I think, you know, personally anyway, it was a difficult few months. It took me a while to readjust to, you know, what COVID had done, not just in the US and around the world, but then when I came back to South Africa, and then that, like you said, led into the professional space where now I was reimagining and trying to figure out how the job I'd be doing was different, because I didn't go straight back into clinical practice. I was working in the Department of Medicine as a research analyst until end of the year last year. So it was, you know, working on COVID, but, you know, the research, the data, the statistics of COVID. And then from January, when the second wave was sort of really starting beginning of this year, then I was back in the hospital. There's a lot of adjustment, you know, trying to get used to everything. But ultimately, I think, you know, realizing what matters most, and, you know, looking after the things that you care about even more than before.
In chapter 6, you speak about the red flags when you were trying to assist a patient at Groote Schuur Hospital. Tell us about that.
Yeah, the red flags, I think when I speak of the red flags, at least in the context of that chapter, is red flags that, you know, you need to, it's like the canary in the coal mine, right? Being able to note or see things that signify greater problems. Like when a patient has all of these physical manifestations and physical symptoms and physiological symptoms, but when you run all the tests, you're not picking up anything. We need to keep in mind that people who are affected by mental health, mental illness, sometimes that presentation of mental illness can be manifested in a physical way. And in that patient in particular, he lost a significant amount of weight that was concerning. And I think in the context of Cape Town, the Western Cape, you know, people who are losing a lot of weight, who are sweating a lot, you know, you're thinking TB. And that's what I was thinking, but all of his tests had come back negative. And when you pick up those red flags, it must guide you to ask different questions to try and get to a different and the real answer, you know, if you can.
Your book also reveals how factors such as government policy and socioeconomics influence disease and medicine. Talk to us about that aspect.
You know, what happens at the bedside inside of a hospital is influenced by everything that's happening outside of that hospital. So the government policy or the healthcare policy or the health system policy or policies which facilitate how good a job or what can be done within those hospitals, those things need to speak to one another. And when they are not speaking to one another, then you start seeing problems at the bedside, and we think that those are problems that are just isolated inside of a hospital. So you look, and a perfect example from this year was what happens outside influences what's happening on the inside. COVID has been its own good example of that, but when there was a lot of the unrest and, you know, protests that are happening in KZN and Gauteng, it was, if you're not prepared or aware of what's happening out in the street, there's violence going on. When it presents into your hospital with people with injuries, those things are related. And if your hospital is not equipped,
yes,
whether with staff, whether with medical supplies, whether with medical resources, you know, in terms of just personnel and consumables, then you're not able to meet the need, which is the medical need. We need to look at the health system in such a way that what we do at the policy level, once we change something there, something is also changing at the bedside. When we change something at the bedside, that must feed back to the policy. Almost like wheels on the same spoke. When I turn one thing, the other one is also turning. Mm. And when you start doing things in isolation, that's when you did get miscommunication.
What advice would you give to someone who wishes to become a medical doctor, especially now as we have seen how the pandemic has affected us?
I don't think I ever want to discourage people from studying medicine, but the one thing that I want to do is encourage people to genuinely look into what it really is being a doctor, being a healthcare professional, because you're not saving lives every single day in the sense that you see on TV. A lot of the days, at least for me, a lot of days, you're seeing the flaws in the health system, the little administrative challenges, the clinical governance challenges, the policy challenges. You're dealing with a lot of those things in different ways every single day as part of your patient care. And sometimes the failures of those things prevents you from genuinely saving a life, right? And I think to look at and speak to people who are working in the system, who've worked in the system, and speak to people who've left medicine to genuinely get an understanding of, why did this person leave? Why did that person leave? What's good, what's not? Because, you know, the one beautiful thing about medicine is you don't have to look far to find meaning. You don't have to look far to find meaning. But if you're not prepared mentally for the things that you see, and it's tough, but also knowing that, you know, you might not have to look far to find meaning, but you're gonna have to work hard to appreciate that meaning. And sometimes you have to sacrifice yourself for that.
And lastly, Doctor, as South Africa battles the pandemic, and we've also seen that the new variant is circulating, how do you advise people who have not vaccinated to do so?
Unfortunate thing is things like vaccinations and, you know, a lot of public health things that people should be doing out of their responsibility, which is part of the rights that they have, has become very political. And I don't know if it's a good or bad thing, that what I would say to those people is, you know what, if you don't want to get a vaccine, let's move on to the next people that want to get vaccinated. Because unfortunately, we spend so much time trying to fight and argue and debate people who ultimately don't actually want to hear an alternative, factual, proven, scientific view. It's the conversation and the debate is on their terms, which are often, it's hard to disprove the ideas and the theories they have because they're not grounded in anything rational, and sometimes not even reality. And it becomes difficult then when you get sucked into disproving something that actually doesn't even exist, you know. And, you know, people are tired. I think that's something else that, you know, people need to keep in mind, is that healthcare professionals, all of them, I think, if people in society are not wanting to get vaccinated, they're not wanting to do their part, when those people get admitted to hospital for whatever reason, the responsibility to speak to those people and convince them to do better, yeah. it cannot get transferred 100% to the healthcare workers, right? Because those people don't exist in vacuums. They exist in communities of people, and there's people who aren't challenging them there. Those people come out of communities and little ecosystems and groups. Yeah. There are people in those groups who know better but not saying anything. And yeah. I think those people must take the responsibility. I know in my circles and you know, people that I know,
yeah,
that's we've fostered that sort of mentality and culture that, hey, if I disagree with you, I'm going to point that out. And if we think one person in our group is doing something that's detrimental to themselves and even other people, we're going to point that out so that they know.
That was Dr. Bookholane speaking to Krima Media's Polity about his book titled Becoming a Doctor.